Good morning, everyone. Welcome along. I think this is the first Wednesday session after the keynote. And we have Jonathan Woithe, thank you, here to give us a little talk on Firewire audio for Linux, the IEEE 1394. That's it, and I'll hand over.
Okay, I'm going to, this talk today is sort of a follow-up to a tutorial type talk that I gave at the multimedia mini-conf, whereas that was more focused on the how to use FFADO. This talk is, whilst we'll touch on that, is more a technical talk and a overview of how I went about some of the protocol analysis that was necessary to get some of this stuff working, why that happened and things along those lines. I'll start just by introducing the Firewire bus and giving a brief overview of some of the stuff that we need to know about to get audio working on the Firewire bus, why the Firewire bus is even an issue for those who want to use audio under Linux, and then get into some of the issues like manufacturer support, protocol analysis techniques, current status and things along those lines. So the FFADO project is, as I mentioned before, producing or aims to produce free audio drivers for Linux that are for devices that take audio and pipe it into the computer through the Firewire bus. So everyone's heard of your PCI sound cards. You plug things in the back of your computer and you get sound in, sound out, it's all good. The motivation for taking the A to D and D to A converters out of the PC and into some external box is that it's much easier to shield all the nasty switching hash from the computer when it's in a totally different box. The problem once it's in a different box is you've got to get that audio from that box into the PC somehow. And these days the two most common platforms for doing that, if you sort of said, well, what would you use? People say, well, USB or Firewire. The USB devices tend to be handled through ALSA for various reasons, and this project is for the Firewire versions. We used to be called FreeBob. Reason we're not called FreeBob anymore is because a couple of vendors that became friendly to the project decided it was too close to a name of a chip from a rival. And to make it easier for us to get more than one vendor to support us, we changed the name to something that was vendor neutral. The consequence of that is that we released FreeBob 1 and the first FFADO release will be version 2. That was our history. So the Firewire bus. A couple of properties of the Firewire bus. It's speeds of 400 and 800 megabits a second today. There's some faster variants under development. You can have up to 63 devices per bus plus the host controller. The bus implements a global address space so that when all the devices are aggregated on the bus, each device is assigned an address space on the bus. It means that the host controller, which in our case is Linux, just basically sees a huge address space, a couple of terabytes, I think it's 48-bit address, I think it is, and each device is a certain part within that address space. So it's a very so you can basically address any device very, very easily. The whole thing's usually abstracted as just a register model, so you've got a device with registers that you write to, and hopefully if you get it right, the device actually does something you want. There are two types of packets that are available for use on the Firewire bus. The first is called async packets or asynchronous packets. They are sent from one device to another device, so it's basically unicast. It's from one it's a point-to-point thing. The thing about the async packets is that there's no timing guarantees at all. The bus will send them when the bus sends them. As a result of that, they're great for doing device configuration. You know, if you say to the device, I want this volume turned up 3 decibels, if that happens, you know, half a millisecond after you wanted it to, it doesn't really matter. The other type of packets are called asynchronous packets or ISO packets. They are broadcast packets. They're sent on one of 64 channels, and that's just a convenience thing more than anything. So that it's a convenience for humans almost than the machines. The channel number is just a way of filtering out the packets so that you know that you get the ones you want. They're broadcast packets, everyone sees them. The important point about them is that there's a guaranteed bandwidth and guaranteed delivery time, so that when you send an ISO packet, you know that A, it will get sent, and B, it will get sent with certain timing guarantees. And that has obvious uses for audio streaming, because with audio, if you don't get a packet in time or you can't send a packet in time, you've missed the time and you can't get it back. So you need those timing guarantees. So some more details about this ISO packet management, because this is important for working out timings. Every second is divided into what they call into a series called ISO cycles. There's 3,072 of them. And each node on the FireWire bus is allowed to send one ISO packet per ISO cycle. And this is where some of the bandwidth guarantees come into play. Within an ISO cycle, it's further subdivided into offsets. They run from 0 to 7999. And finally, we have an ISO clock, which runs at around 24 megahertz. And you can see the arithmetic there about how that comes about. The important thing about the ISO clock is that it's synchronous across the bus. So all the devices see the ISO clock and know what... It's like a timing reference across the entire FireWire bus. And that clock then drives an ISO counter, which allows devices to keep track of time on the bus, and that counter wraps once every 128 seconds. I refer to the Asynchronous Resource Manager at times in this talk, the IRM, and that's really just the device that is the master clock source, and that is, we have no direct control over which device gets that. It's a negotiated thing on the bus itself. And so, generally speaking, the devices fight it out amongst themselves, and the one that's most, that basically is most pervasive is the one that wins. Most of the time that'll be an audio device, because audio devices really want to be the master. And then finally, the IRM also is the thing that dictates or manages the ISO bandwidth. So what happens is that when the bus resets, all the devices say, I want this much bandwidth. And the ISO, the IRM basically keeps track of this and says yes, 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 until the bandwidth's used up, and then any further requests are denied. And that way the devices that got their requests know that they can send the data and it will get through. Those that missed out have to live with it. And that's just, this is just a diagram that sort of summarises what I've just said. We've got each second is divided into the ISO cycles. Each cycle has 8,000 ticks in it. And then at the 128 second mark, the ISO cycle goes from 127 back to zero and wraps around that way. We don't need 128 seconds of accumulated counters. Well, we'd basically be quite happy with about 10, but this is what the standard provides, so we use it. Not for us, no. In fact, we tend to pretty much ignore the second field completely. We don't need it, and we'll show why in a minute. If we ever needed it, we would program it in. But our timing code is safe from the rollover. And I mean, 128 seconds isn't very long. If it's going to work, you've got to deal with the rollover. So why do we use FireWire for audio? Why not just stick with USB? The high bandwidth is useful. You can get about 32 channels of high definition audio across that. 24-bit 48K gets you 32 channels. If you're willing to lose a few channels, you can go right up to your 192K sampling. The bus bandwidth of 400 or 800 megabits a second is fully accessible, or almost fully accessible, to the devices. And the devices can have guaranteed bandwidth. So both of those two things mean that it suits the streaming applications really, really well. Biggest thing is slow devices can't block the faster ones. And it's those last three bullet points which is why USB isn't all that suitable for this. There's no bus bandwidth guarantees under USB at all. Slow devices can just block a high profile device if they want to, and they can lock things up and for milliseconds at a time. And also that advertised 480 megabits a second USB 2 isn't actually really available for devices to use. So Firewire for streaming time critical data is much, much better for USB. The general rule of thumb in the pro audio area is that you can get by with about 4 channels across USB without too much trouble, but once you start trying to pipe much more than that, things just go pear-shaped really quickly. So we want to pipe audio through Firewire. How do we do that? The most obvious problem that you've got is that you need sample accurate synchronization. You need to know that when I send this sample out in a certain amount of time, that will be played through the interface, and you need to know that timing. The problem is that unlike a PCI bus, you don't have access or direct access to the audio clock in the device. On most PCI things, you can query it very quickly, you can find out what the phase of the clock is, and you can lock to that very, very easily. On Firewire, you've got this cable, and it's a remote device, and you can't just do that. You can't query the clock hardware to find out where it is. I mentioned that there is a synchronous clock across the bus called the ISO clock, but the devices don't lock to that. They don't lock the audio to that. One of the problems, although PLLs can get around it to a certain extent, is that 44.1K isn't easily derived from the ISO clock frequency. 48K is, but 44.1 isn't. And the other problem is that the audio device may not, in fact, be the IRM. So it may not even be the master clock generator. So the practical upshot of this is that the ISO clock, whilst it can be a good timing reference, it's not related to the master audio clock in any way. So what tends to happen is that the devices are sending data to the computer, and they will timestamp those samples in some way, and they'll timestamp them with the value of the ISO counter at the time of the respective sampling. So we've got a series of samples coming into the computer. Each one is timestamped, and it's timestamped with this ISO counter. And then we can use those to synthesize our own copy of the audio clock, which we can then use to put into the packets we send to the device to tell the device when to play our packets out. So I've got a diagram of this. It's a bit hard to explain the concept of it. One of the problems with the ISO counter is that it's integer. And as this diagram is showing, down the bottom we've got a series. It's basically a timeline, and you can imagine that this is, say, a sequence of 4 audio samples at, say, 48 kilohertz. So in the first situation there, we have the ISO cycle 10 occurs, then we have an audio clock. And so the ISO offset that will be stored associated with that sample will be 10. We then go to the next clock cycle, and we see that at the time of the transition of the audio clock, the current ISO cycle offset number is 522. So that's the number that goes through. If you notice, you'll see that because we're not sample locked, though, that audio clock is drifting with respect to the ISO cycle clock, and so when we come to the next sample, we see that the offset number corresponding to the audio sample is 1035. And the difference between that and the previous one is 513, not 512. And this is what makes our job for FFADO rather awkward, because the difference in the cycle offsets, even for a nice round number like 48K, we've still got variable differences between them, but the resolution of the ISO offset isn't sufficient by itself to be able to give us an accurate indication of where we are with the sample clock. And so what we have to do is take those differences and feed them into a thing called a delay lock loop, which allows us to synthesize to a much greater accuracy where we are in terms of the ISO cycle for the samples. And we need that accuracy because when we want to send data to the device, we need to run the cycle clock forward, we need to run the audio clock forward in time in the computer to work out what those ISO cycles will be when we want to play it out. And so simply having integer values for our differences are no good, then the accuracy just isn't there. And the reason why the accuracy isn't there is because the devices themselves get really upset if you get this wrong. Some of them are really good, but some of them, if you get it wrong by like one ISO offset, the device just dies and blows up, loses sync, and that's it, you're over. So we need to use this DLL for this. The problem with the DLL is that the way it basically works is that when you get a new sample coming in, you use your current value of the delay lock loop to predict what it would have been. You look at what you got, and then you feed a fraction of that difference back into the delay lock loop to basically correct for the stuff that you got wrong. And the problem with that is that you can choose coefficients for that feedback which are either very, very fast at settling but have a lot of jitter, or they're very slow at settling but don't have a lot of jitter. And we don't want a lot of jitter. So the way we pull that under FADO is that we have two sets of coefficients, and we use a fast settling one for the first second or so, and then we switch to a much lower jitter one before we actually start sending audio sampling to prevent jitter on the timing. A couple of other issues that we need to compensate for is transport delays. We've got delays through the Firewire stack, we've got delays in the device, you've got cable delays and this sort of thing. And the DLL tends to take care of this for us, transparently, because inherent within the functionality of the DLL, we correct for those timing differences, which is really, really helpful, because the timing differences are not constant and will change if you change the arrangement of devices on your Firewire bus. So if you've got one audio device, you'll have a certain set of latencies. If you've got daisy-chained another one on the end of that, you'll have a different set of latencies. And so we need to take care of that. And then finally, I did mention this briefly, that the audio clock is really, we really need to be very picky about the accuracy of that. And to give you some idea, the devices that I'm directly involved in, if we don't use a double, 64-bit double float for that clock, I can't get the accuracy that I need to make the device happy. It's that picky. And it's partly to do with the accumulation of errors as well, that if you don't use a double, the errors that you accumulate are very large, partly because of this 128 second accumulation in the cycle clock, in the cycle counter as well. That loses you effectively three decimal places at the other end, and things blow up really quickly. FireWire interface chipsets. Inside your computer, when you've got a FireWire device, you have a chipset that drives it. Some are good, some are really bad. This isn't actually a Linux-specific problem. If you log on to the website of Motu or RME or any of the higher-end device manufacturers, you will find, without too much hassle, an FAQ item about which FireWire chipset should I use. And they all say, basically, use TI. Do you have a question? Right, the comment's just been made that sometimes it's not just the chipset, that if you have a laptop, in some cases you can have a laptop, if you plug it into the wall, it makes the makes the FireWire unusable because of the effect of the power supply, which is bizarre. I've summarised on this slide just basically what's good, what's bad. Older NEC and VIA chipsets were really buggy and can't be used. Ricoh's are patchy. Recent VIAs are apparently okay. I don't have any direct experience of that, but others have on the lists have reported that they've been okay with the more recent versions of the VIAs. I tend to just say, to keep things easy, and because there's still a lot of cards out there with the older chipsets on it, that you know, if you're going to start with this stuff, get yourself a TI-based card, even if it's a PCMCIA for your laptop, because it does solve a lot of trouble. And we've had so many people on the mailing list that have, you know, reported all these massive timing troubles and jitter problems and everything's crapping out, and then they change it for a TI chipset and everything's good. So manufacturer support. Ideally, well, they're all audio devices, they all run on FireWire, so let's have some sort of class compliant interface that everyone talks. That means that we just have one common driver that drives all interfaces and everyone's happy. But There are published standards. The IEC's put out 61883, which basically covers AV devices really, really nicely. The problem is that most of the manufacturers have decided that they can do better. And so they, at best, invent their own specific extensions to do device control. So although the standard says you can do volume control this way, they say, well, that's rubbish, we'll do it this way. And they don't document it. Other manufacturers decide that they can do better at everything, and so they invent something completely different and often completely unrelated to any standard that's published. The practical upshot of that is that for these sorts of manufacturers, we need some support from them to tell us how to drive their interfaces. Only they know the extensions and the details of their extensions. If they've invented their own protocol, only they know the protocol. Some vendors have come on board. Echo, Focusrite, Mackie are supporting us. They're giving us devices. They're giving us internal documentation about the protocols, which makes it easier for us to implement the details. We're also getting support from BridgeCo and TCAT, which are two of the main platform vendors for these devices. So that's good. The problem is that we have a number of manufacturers that are uncooperative. Was that a question?
Yeah, I was just going to ask, Is Motu still bad?
I'll get to that. Question was, is Motu still bad? There are two options when you have uncooperative vendors. These are vendors that basically tell us to go away, we're not interested. The first is to forget them. And there's a lot of people in the open source world that subscribe to this view. I don't believe this is good PR in the audio area. And the reason I don't believe it's good PR in the audio area is because we are trying to encourage people to move to Linux. And whether or not we want to accept it or not, people who are moving to Linux have already got another system that works, and they've got often thousands of dollars invested in interfaces. And if we turn around and tell them, yeah, sure, you can move to Linux, but you've got to throw out all your interfaces and buy new ones, it isn't going to fly. They're not going to do it. And so my view is that we support these as best we can, but for the people who are buying new devices to use under Linux, we actively encourage them to buy from the manufacturers that do support us. And over time, things will pan out and get better. The question was asked whether Motu is still bad. Motu is still bad. They don't support us at all. And the situation with Motu is probably more complicated than most because their interfaces are at the development of their interfaces, they outsource to a totally different company. And so the company that actually has the information we need is not actually Motu itself. But we as users can only talk to Motu support people. So there's probably no one in Motu who actually has the knowledge to realise that the stuff we need isn't their intellectual property. So to get anything out of them is probably going to be extremely problematic, and until they themselves come to realise this, it's probably going to continue to be difficult.
Is it the same role?
The FA66 and 101 are supported. They use the DM1000 chip from BridgeCo. FreeBob supports them, FFADO does as well. No one's even bothered with... Actually, I think somebody did email DigiDesign and they politely said no. But that's not surprising because DigiDesign aren't interested in supporting anything other than their own hardware and software. Their hardware is basically a $10,000 software dongle. So when you've got awkward people who don't support you, you've basically got... And you decide you want to support, you've got to somehow get access to this traffic. So when I bought a Traveller before any of this had been done, mainly from Motu, because at the time it was the only device that actually supported the stuff I needed the device to do. I don't have infinite money and I needed it to do a set number of things, and that was a device that matched. So I had a device, I want to make this work under Linux. FireWire, as it turns out, you can in fact sniff the packets, possibly easier than you can with USB. You can put a second PC on the bus, and that PC can see the broadcast traffic, which is great because the broadcast traffic is the audio data. And so without too much hassle, you can capture those packets, have a look at them, and it's not that hard to work out the formats used for 24-bit audio. It's pretty obvious. The problem is that the ISO packets only give us the audio data. They don't tell us anything about the controller interface. So we don't know from that how to turn the device on, off, how to turn the mixers on or off, how to activate phantom power on some of the devices. Basically, without the asynchronous packets, we can't get the device to do anything. We can't even start it streaming audio. And it turns out that the FireWire cards or chipsets that are in everybody's laptops are based on the OHCI chipset, which is great because it means one device drives those chipsets. It's bad because a by-design hardware limitation of OHCI is that unless an asynchronous packet is passed addressed to you, the hardware drops it before the operating system has a chance of seeing it. It means that with a standard OHCI card, we cannot sniff the async packets at all, and that's a hardware problem. You can get purpose-designed analysis hardware. It's expensive. But fortunately, there are a couple of alternatives. I basically list them here. There's an alternative chipset called a PCI Links chipset. It was made by TI, originally designed for use in hardware protocol analyzers. But some people had the bright idea, well, let's put these on PCI cards for those who want to use them. And so they do, and you can still buy a couple. You can still buy them if you look close enough on the web. You can get them for as little as 100 US, and you can use them with a software called Nosy under Linux. And that combination allows us to capture the async packets on the FireWire bus, and that's in fact the route that I used when I was doing the Motu work. I haven't tried this myself, but apparently some of the G3 Power Macs with Apple's Firebug software can be used to do the similar thing because they use the PCI Links chipset as well. Just make a note there that the latest Nosy release 0.3 is really old and you need a recent one to work with recent kernels, but it does still work. There is another software program that I came across a couple of months back called BusHound. You can run BusHound runs on operating systems supported by your vendor of your hardware device, so in this case Windows or macOS. It basically installs its own driver layer very deep in the Windows driver stack and intercepts every driver call on the system, and it can filter out the bits that you're interested in. It's very, very expensive. It's about 700 US, but there is a free version which, with a few limitations, you can coerce into getting most of the information that we need. And I've talked someone through using this on a one of the other Motu devices to help me work out what was going on with them. You've got to have a Windows computer around to use it though. The other possibility, this is all vaporware at the moment, and that is sniffing via a virtual machine. If we had Qemu or VirtualBox or one of those with with FireWire pass-through, we could actually install Windows under that virtual environment and sniff the packets as it passed through the virtual machine. That would be fantastic because it would mean that almost anyone could help us with the packet sniffing and they wouldn't have to outlay anything for special hardware. To my knowledge, no one's working on this on any VM system that I'm aware of at the moment. It's not in Qemu, it's not in VirtualBox, commercial or otherwise. I don't even think VMware does it, but I could be wrong there, but VMware is not good because we can't get access to the source to pick out the packets. If someone wanted to do this, this would be fantastic for our project. In terms of actually doing the protocol analysis, it's very, very similar to Tridge's French cafe technique, which he's described at length in earlier conferences. Essentially, we capture the async packets as they fly past, and based on those packet contents, we work out how things work. So we might change the sample rate of the device on the other computer, watch the packets fly past, then do it again and see what happens and see what's different for the different sample rates. And by doing that for every device control operation, we can build up a picture of the register map of the devices, and then from that we can work out what we've got to poke at and throw at in order to get the results that we need. The capturing is really, really easy. You can generally do it for a device in about 2 or 3 hours. Analyzing it takes a lot longer. And some devices are easier than others. There is a device out there that uses a given register for two totally different things depending on whether you read it or you write it. The problem with this is that you can get no clue about the read side interface by writing to it, and you can't get any idea of the right side by reading it. Most devices aren't like that, but there are some that make it really awkward. Another possible way of doing this is what I call indirect analysis, and this is really a last-ditched effort if you cannot get any other way of capturing packets. This doesn't work for those devices that have different functions on read or write. But on devices that basically read back the value you've just written, this can give you some clue as to how to control the device. Effectively, you take a snapshot of the device registers, then you do something to the device, then you take another snapshot of the device registers and compare and look at what's different. This is fairly limited because you lose all idea of the sequence. So if there's like four different registers being changed and the order of change is important, then this technique doesn't give you any information about that, and you've got to deduce that sort of thing by trial and error, which can be very problematic. The big advantage of it is that no one has to buy special hardware to do it, and so it can help in certain circumstances. I wrote a tool called Scan Dev Reg, which is in the FFADO trunk, which basically implements this. I've used it a couple of times with people just to clarify a few things, but because of the nature of the timing and the fact you lose that temporal information, it really augments the other methods rather than being a first call process. So as I said, this is just a brief slide about how FFADO sort of fits. FFADO fits into the audio system as a jack backend. It's got a dedicated backend, so it's a peer to the ALSA backend in a way. We plan an ALSA driver. It's been a low priority thus far because the interfaces we're talking about are the sorts of interfaces that you want to use with software that's basically jack-enabled. And so the motivation for spending time on an ALSA driver is fairly low. We need access to the real-time scheduling, which is different to the real-time patches of the kernel. We also need read-write access to DevRaw 1394, which, if you've got a multi-user machine, is potentially a security problem. There is a problem with USB. USB, because of the driver architecture, can sometimes lock interrupts for a rather long time. And it can lock interrupts long enough that we miss Firewire packets coming in. If we miss Firewire packets coming in, all of our timing information that we're getting from those incoming packets gets upset. And we can no longer predict correct timestamps for the data that we send. The practical upshot of that is that basically the device loses sync and you've got to restart FFADO. If you've got a system which unfortunately shares the Firewire interrupt with a USB hub, this is much more problematic. On my laptop, the Firewire interrupt is unique, and so the only time that USB causes my laptop to die with FFADO is if I actually plug in a device. But we've got users who can move their USB mouse and it kills FFADO because of the locked interrupts. There are plans to fix this. Which I'll get to in a minute. The real-time scheduling configuration is a problem because it's not done by most people normally, and we're trying to work out a way of making this a lot easier to do, whether it's going to involve a part of an install script that actually changes the PAM configuration to give this or whatever. We're not sure yet, but it could be easier. I mentioned the scheduling issues. I'm working with Sven at the moment to on an updated version of the threaded IRQ patch for the kernel. What this basically does is it takes the ideas of the threaded IRQ component of Ingo's real-time patch and generalizes it so that it's hopefully more usable and more acceptable for mainline. Yes? Yes.
How does that relate to having to recompile your kernel with low latency?
Okay. The question is, how does the real-time scheduling relate to the RT patch for the kernel and recompiling your kernel for low latency? Yeah. The real-time scheduler is basically one of the scheduling algorithms built into the kernel. It's in mainline. It's an option. When you go into the kernel configuration, and I forget where it's exactly where it is, but it's basically the can't remember the submenu it's in now, but basically you can choose between low latency desktop, server preemption, or one other option if you don't have the RT patch. And for us, the low latency desktop is acceptable for a scheduling algorithm. This is just an algorithm, so it's really just telling the kernel when it's going to do stuff. What the RT patch does from Ingo is that it reduces the scheduling latency within the kernel by making most of it preemptible. And so in the stock standard kernel, there's a large number of areas in the kernel which, once they enter, they will not be preempted until they finish. And unfortunately, the USB stack in particular has a rather large component of its IRQ handler which actually locks all interrupts for a rather long period of time. And the consequence of that is that our interrupts for FireWire don't get handled, we miss packets. So, the RT scheduling is the algorithm that's used, but in terms of making the kernel completely preemptible, that's when you need the RT patch. Having said that, if you're not worried about latency, if you're happy with like 50 millisecond latency, which is fine for offline recording work, you don't need the RT patch at all. I run with low latency desktop on a mainline kernel, and I don't have a problem. If, however, you want to go sub 10 millisecond latency, you want to do real-time effects through your FADO system, that's when you need the RT patch, because basically the kernel doesn't get to schedule our processes fast enough if you don't have that. One of the other things I'll just note about that is that Peter Palmer, who's one of the other primary devs of FADO, is actually thinking about putting some of the FADO components into the kernel to circumvent some of these timing problems that we're seeing. If that happens, it'll export a standard ASA interface. We don't know yet. We think we won't need to, but we're not sure yet. We're working on it. It's an idea that he's had, because one of the other advantages that we get if we go into kernel is that we can actually exercise the OHCI chipset a lot better. And don't have some other issues that we have going through Libraw 1394. So our current status is we're in beta testing, effectively, for the 2.0 release. I think that'll come out probably in the next month or so. That'll support anything based on the DM1000 or DM1500 chips from Bridge Co. So your Focusrite, Sapphires, the Edelwell devices we talked about before. All the Echo FireWire devices will be supported, mostly because Echo has been really, really good with support for us and have given us sample hardware and also access to internal developers. And also a selection of Motu devices. I should point out that the 828 Mark III, which was released about 12 months ago, I'm working on, but that one is a lot more complicated because it's added a lot more internal controls, so there's a lot more sync packets to work out. And I don't have one, so I'm working with someone who's overseas doing that. As I said, Motu aren't helping us at all. Now, one of the things that came up last year and it keeps coming up on the mailing lists are, what about RME? They will be supported as of 2 weeks ago. Basically, we have now managed to get contact with the RME developers to the point where we can get information about how to drive their devices, and we are being supported with subsidized devices. I now have the documentation. It's under NDA, but I can write a GPL driver based on that information, so that's all good. The sample hardware almost came before the conference, but we ran out of time just to negotiate a few things, so that has all but been obtained. So the practical upshot of that is that the RME FireWire devices, so we're talking the Fireface 400 and the Fireface 800, will be supported by FADO. I'm not sure exactly when. It's going to depend a bit on how much time I get over the next couple of months. I'm hoping to have something to play with in the net by about mid-year, but we'll see how we go. Fortunately, the documentation is in a format that is actually fairly usable. It's actually quite well written. So I'm hoping that there's not going to be too many troubles transferring that into the FADO architecture, and we'll see how that all goes. But that is actually really good news, because with RME on board, it gives us a little more clout when talking to manufacturers that are still being uncooperative. Our future plans: we want to support more devices, we want to work with vendors to get better cooperation and to educate those who still don't understand. The device mixer interfaces that I've only briefly mentioned today, we have a Python-based GUI to control mixers on the devices. So this is to control onboard mixers, phantom power, all the other fancy switches and things that you can do to these devices. That needs a little bit more refining. It's still a bit rough around the edges, so there's some work to do on that. We want to lower the CPU consumption. Managing a 64-bit float DLL actually consumes quite a bit of CPU. On my 2-gig laptop, it's about, if I run FADO on my Motu Traveler, it's about a between 8 and 10% CPU utilization. That's miles too high. We want to work out ways of lowering that. And it's probably going to be involve work in the DLL more than anything else. One of the big problems that we've got with these interfaces is that most of them send 24-bit data to the device, which means that there's an inherent 32-bit to 24-bit conversion that needs to happen for each and every audio sample, and it can't be accelerated, because at least some of the devices don't use 32-bit aligned data buffers. They use packed 24-bit. So you cannot use MMX and you can't use SSE or any of those. We want to improve the synchronization stability and recovery. That's coming along quite well now, but there's still issues that we want to sort out. And there's some outstanding issues too about how all this might interface to jack clients and when jack clients are actually running, because the nature of these devices is it takes of the order of seconds to resynchronize a device. So the question is, what does jack do while the device is resynchronizing? We haven't really sorted that one out yet. And just a note there about how some of the streaming code may move into the kernel because of timing constraints and hardware utilization. So finally, how can people help? They can help by purchasing from vendors who are friendly, and then telling those friendly vendors that they're purchasing because they're supporting Linux. Conversely, if you're not going to purchase from an unfriendly vendor, you tell them why you're doing that as well. Because this is the only way that the vendors find out that A, there is interest in Linux, and B, that there's a payback for their investment in Linux if they have in fact been a friendly vendor. If we don't tell them that we're buying because they support us, or that we're not buying because they don't, they have no way of knowing it. If you tell them, you ring them up, you send them an email, it goes into their tracking system on their help desk, and the managers read that. But it's the only way that you can get past the salespeople. It's a slow process, but the more people that do that, the better. Yes?
Given that most people buy their code or AR or whatever from a couple of schools or some high street retailer, how is the vendor ever going to find out about it?
Question is, how does if you buy from a street store like Apple Shop or whatever, how does a vendor find out that you're using it with Linux? You tell them. They've all got sales at motu.com and sales at rme.com and all the others, right? They've all got these customer support helplines. Mail them. Email them. Yep. Yep. And if they're not supporting us, you say, I was considering buying your XYZ device, but you're hostile to Linux, so I'm not. I'm buying this instead. That helps as well. The other big thing is to, if you have an interface, download it. Download FADO snapshots, test them, report bugs, report regressions, report everything. None of us developers have an infinite amount of resources to be able to buy all these interfaces. I'm trying to support Motu devices. I have exactly one of them. I can't afford to buy all of them. So if other people who've got them can help us by testing, it helps us. And then, of course, if you really do have some money, you can lend or donate devices to us so that we can support them. And just want to acknowledge Daniel Wagner and Peter Palmers, who also have done a lot of work on FADO to make it work. And then those companies again who are actively supporting us, and especially RME for finally coming on board and giving us some support to support their really cool interfaces. Users who report bugs and all the patience they have when we accidentally break something and on something and takes us 3 weeks to work out why. And then finally, I've just got a couple of links here that summarise the more important URLs of the parts that I've touched on today in this talk that you can investigate at your own time. My email address is there. I'm always willing to hear from new people who are using these interfaces in crazy ways and doing, and especially those that are actually willing to test interfaces that we just don't have. They spontaneously test it and report back, and that's what starts this whole support process for those new interfaces. So I just encourage those who have the opportunity to help us in that respect as well. So that's it.
Yeah, thank you, Jonathan. Did anyone have any questions? Tie off. Yeah, we did. So I think that's it. Well, thank you. And for Jonathan, we have some localized gifts here.
Oh, thank you.
Some nice little bit of, well, that's hand lotion there.
Okay.
And we have a from the Lark Distillery, just down in the city, a little bit of a bush liqueur made here in Tasmania. So thank you again, Jonathan.